Maybe you guys can talk a little bit about Bandzoogle and what it is you guys offer.
Absolutely. Well, thanks, Mike, for having us, and thanks to everyone's online checking this out. It's an amazing honor, and we're excited to be here. Bandzoogle is an almost 10-year-old internet company. What we provide is a platform where anyone, we're targeting artists, musicians, bands, songwriters, where anyone can come and build their own website. So I can show you our homepage. I definitely encourage you to check it out, bandzoogle.com. You can design your website either using one of our themes or one of our templates, when we have hundreds that you can choose from, or we have a technology that lets you completely customize your own design. If you go to our website and click on our list of features, you'll see all that we have in there. But all you need for an artist website is included, and that includes the media players, a photo gallery, tour calendar. If you want to have your own blog, you can do that on our platform. We also have a store, so you can sell your digital music or physical CDs or merch, and we don't take any cut of your sales. We also have mailing list management. If you want to manage your mailing list, send regular newsletters or email blasts, and all that is included in a monthly subscription. It's a free trial, and it's in a super affordable monthly subscription. We should probably start looking at some of the people online, their website, and quickly review them.
Yes.
Giving you more examples.
Okay, so we've got a couple here. Why don't we start with Renee Winter, and it's just Renee Winter, spelled as it sounds, .com.
That's a Bandzoogle website. So thank you, Renee, for being a Bandzoogle customer. Dave, what's your first impression of her? Before we jump into the review, maybe I can, like, when we look at websites, we kind of have a cheat sheet of things we look for, but it's three main themes. The first one is we'll look at the website's design. So we'll look if the design feels modern and if it works well with the artist's brand or what they're trying to project as a brand. Then we'll look at how the site is organized. Mm-hmm. Like, what are the different pages? How is the homepage organized? Is it easy to find what I'm looking for? Is there a strong call to action? And then we'll look at the content. Is it good content? Nicely highlighted? Is it a good mix of, like, more personal content that really comes from the artist, versus professional content that is like more like, this is who I am, and here is my next tour date, and my album is available here and when. Mm-hmm. So those are the things that we look for. So back to Renee's website.
First impression, clean homepage. There's not too much clutter. Again, going back to a great call to action for her mailing list there. Get Renee's upcoming single, free when you sign up for her newsletter. It's really great to offer an incentive. You want to really get those email addresses. So offering, a free MP3 or exclusive content that people can't find anywhere else online is a good idea. Again, she has her social links clearly laid out. Not too many of them, just the primary ones. Her latest news and some clear navigation on her site.
I'd like to have some music there.
Yeah.
I'd like to see a video, because right now, two things that are missing is, like, there's no pitch. Like, all we know is what she looks like and her name right now.
Yeah.
I'd like to see if she's, like Tyler, like, just a couple minutes ago, like, singer, songwriter, piano man. She could say where she's from, what kind of music she plays, but also having a big play button from either her latest video or her latest track would be nice. At least, her music section is easy to find, so that's a good thing. Mm-hmm. If this video is pretty good, she could bring it, also put it on the homepage.
Now, this might be like an urban myth, but what I was always told is that, every time you make someone click, you're going to lose 30% of them.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
Something
and
like
scroll.
Yeah. So yeah, you want to have kind of very your best content right on your homepage.
Yeah, definitely.
So we're about, see, she has it here on our bio page, Nerd, Awkward, Crazy Redhead, Cat Lady, Sense of Human, Soulful, Jazzy, Piano, Pop Maker.
That should be on the homepage.
That could be either on the homepage or even part of her header image.
Mm-hmm.
And then her bio is pretty long, which is a good thing. But like most lazy bloggers will just copy paste this. Mm-hmm. So having like two versions of the bio, either one that is a couple sentence or a paragraph, and then having a longer version of the bio is a good thing.
Now, does Rene have the ability to have a header in here in the bio, like a, like again, like an H1 that would be more apt to be picked up by the you know, Google robots?
Yeah.
So that she might want to have this as a little bit of a larger font, you know, because I think the robots hold that, they make that a little bit weightier.
Yeah, it won't make a huge difference, but it makes a small difference. Mm-hmm. So she definitely could do that. Otherwise, with her video page was good. Shows, upcoming shows, you know, that's good. Like, it's important to keep the shows page always up to date. It doesn't make you look good if someone goes to your shows page and there's only a date for, you know, from last May in there. Mm. So make sure to keep that updated and have all the info that people need. So that's pretty good. She's got the address, the time. There's no tickets, but that's fine. She has a photo gallery. It's a good idea to have at least one or two professional high resolution pictures that, again, either bloggers, journalists, or, you know, promoters can take and use for whatever content you need to create.
I love this organization of her photos as well, because sometimes you'll land on an artist's website and there's just this huge photo gallery that's a mix of live shots, fan photos, promo shots. So if I'm a member of the industry who's looking for a promo shot, I want to be able to find that super quick.
Yeah.
So the way she laid it out there is like there's live photos and then there's more, you know, the promotional photos.
She has a blog, so she seems to be pretty good at creating personal content. That's really good. Fans love that. Like if you're really putting yourself out there as an artist, that's excellent. Our store is coming soon, so we won't comment on it. But it's good that she has it as a menu item. Like, store is important. Like, if someone's coming to your website willing to give you some of their hard-earned dollars, make it as easy as possible.
And speaking of that, there's a huge debate in the music industry right now whether you should even be charging for music or giving it away for free. And with our store feature and other stores, I mean, you can set it to pay what you want.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I always tell artists, if someone wants to give you their money, let them give you their money.
Yeah.
And if they want it for free, at least get their email address.
Yeah, right.
So the pay what you want model is interesting, because then you get their email address no matter what, and the people who want to pay you will pay you.
How does e-commerce work if someone is using Bandzoogle? Can they offer a range of items, whatever they want? How does it work exactly?
I can show you a quick example. I like to show Natalie's website because her store has a bunch of a good number of nice options. But yeah, you on Bandzoogle, you can do two things. You can sell digital items. So digital items, people can buy either a track or an album.
Mm-hmm.
You can set the price or have it be pay what you want or have it be free.
Mm-hmm.
And then we have the infrastructure to provide the download. We also have infrastructure if you want to use download codes and print out cards and or put codes on merch, things like that. And you can also sell any physical item. So in her case, her store has CDs. You can get a poster. You can get downloads. And a while ago she had T-shirts in there. But you could say, I want to buy the 10-pack pre-sale. Do I want it signed or not? Then add to cart. We process payment using PayPal.
Mm-hmm.
So within a few clicks, people click checkout, enter their PayPal address, and then it's done. So it doesn't take 12 clicks to get them to actually buy your stuff.
Got it.
And we don't interface with fulfillment, so we send you the purchase order. So if anything digital we take care of, but anything physical, we'll send you a purchase order and say, Mike at that address in Boston just bought a red T-shirt or a CD.
So the artist would be responsible for fulfillment?
Yeah, some of them just forward that email, forward that email to their fulfillment partner. Mm-hmm. Some of them go to the post office every Friday and mail the stuff out. It's as you want. Should we look at another URL?
If we're good with Renee.
Okay. Dave, any first impressions? Is that a Flash player? Yeah, that's a Flash player.
So the
player that's on top there probably won't work on any Apple device. So on, I guess we could check. But if you are, what's his name, Chewy? If you're Chewy, you should make sure that your website is fully functional on iPhones, iPads, iPods. That's the first thing I would do. The site isn't Flash though, but that player on top there, that seems to be Flash.
I find the header image a bit small.
Yeah, it could be a bit bigger.
I'd like to see it a bit bigger.
Obviously the branding is strong. Like I can tell from just looking at the background, the header image, and even just the band's name that it's not like a nice country singer-songwriter, you know. From, mm-hmm. So it seems like pretty dark music. So they got that branding okay. You could play music here using the Flash player here, so that's good. At least there's music very quickly on the website. That I would keep for a bio page, like the long bio, who exactly is in the band, and the all these paragraphs here. I wouldn't put that on the homepage. I would put it like I said earlier, like a short pitch for the band. And maybe a video or track. There's video here, so that's good.
Yeah, these guys, are they playing Flying V's there? That's a what's a Gibson Explorer, I think, right? So if you have a band where two guys are playing Gibson Explorers, that should be the focus, right?
Yeah, yeah. That should be right.
You gotta have it. Yeah.
I'd much rather see the band's latest news here on the homepage to show their activity. Rather, like, that's a full bio that should be in there. There should be a bio set, which there doesn't seem to be. So there should be a bio or an about section where if I want to learn more about the band, then I'll click there. But, you know, a short elevator pitch on the homepage with the latest news, I think, would be.
And it's not clear what the main call to action is, because right now the homepage is trying to get me to add them on Facebook, YouTube, Twitter, MySpace, Reverb Nation, Sonic Bids, join the mailing list. I know they're playing it at the Red Eye Fly in Austin.
It's a cool place.
There's a video. Yeah, it's a cool place. And there's a pitch right here. So maybe that should be like on this side, on the other side, as part of the homepage. Like, it's kind of an afterthought here.
Yeah.
I would bring that back above the fold and maybe focus on one make call to action, and that would make the homepage much better.
Really,
and maybe change that image.
This prime real estate connect with IOD, I think, should be used differently, you know, because, I mean, this is a question for you guys. If I was at Red Eyed Fly, I heard of this band, I Googled and I found their site, right? Is it a best practice to send me to Reverb Nation from here or Sonic Biz?
I don't think so, because, well, it depends what your goal is. Like, if like right now, a lot of bands are super active on Facebook, Twitter, and they post a lot of videos on YouTube. Those are kind of like the main three. Mm-hmm. If you're active there, yes, you should try to convince your fans to follow you there. Mm. But use those to bring traffic back to your website as often as possible.
Right.
Because the website is where you completely control the design and narrative the context you want to wrap your art in, right? And that's where you get people to sign up for the mailing list, which we mentioned is super important. And that's where people can go to your store and get more of your information, versus on Facebook, they get your latest update, maybe, because we know that not all of your Facebook followers.
It's a recent change,
see it.
Made it harder.
And then they get distracted by their other friends that post something. Same thing on YouTube, like they'll watch your video, but then YouTube's gonna suggest different videos that have nothing to do with your band.
Yeah.
So make them watch that video on your website.
Well, we did talk about the importance of email in terms of conversion and staying in touch, and it's a high-performing marketing vehicle. If I'm looking at this, I would tend to want to swap
absolutely.
This, you know,
and
have an incentive.
Yeah, I was going to say that. Have an incentive. It's great that they have that call to action there, but describe what fans are going to get in return.
Yeah, and why would I join your mailing list? Are you going to be spamming me every day or sending out like a monthly update newsletter? Like, you can say, please sign up for our mailing list, we'll send you free tracks and you know, updates from our tour, things like that will say, well, I'm interested in signing up.
I do like that this band has a blog, and I wonder if that content is updated, if that might be something that should be pulled to the homepage.
There's no content that's loading, so I don't know what's going on, if it's a bug or if there's just no content.
Okay.
Otherwise, calendar, that's good. It's good to have. It might be, yeah, it's good to have. It's good to have a calendar page, especially if you're touring. Audio. See, that's strange. Like, having tracks playable like this, I'm not a big fan of, because I'd rather have a playlist.
Yeah.
Like, I'm assuming if I play this now, then when the song stops, I have to go click on the next track. Whereas if you have it more as a playlist, like your fan, it might be like spend the next half hour listening to your tunes mm-hmm. on your website, which is a good thing. So I would change that and use more of a fully featured player, photo gallery. Oh, I didn't click on store. Yeah, that's kind of awkward, like blind links like that, where I know there's something, but if I click on it, I'm not sure what I'm gonna get. Mm-hmm. That's a link to City Baby.
So that's already several clicks to see where you're
just to get to City Baby. I had to click 3 times. That's not ideal. And then there's a good chance I won't go back to the website. And maybe I wanted to buy the other EP as well. Mm-hmm. So that's kind of an awkward navigation.
Ease of use is so important, yeah. Right?
Especially with purchasing, you know, mm-hmm. have to make it like really, really easy for people to make a purchase.
CD, okay, so that was the physical CD and then the digital. I'm assuming it sends me to also CD Baby. Yeah, iTunes, Amazon, Bandcamp. Yeah. All of those are good, but the missed opportunity if you send people to iTunes or Amazon is that they take 30% of your revenue, but you can't, you don't know who bought your track or your EP on iTunes. You don't have their email address.
That's the thing. Yeah.
Whereas if you sell it directly from your website, and I'm not sure about CD Baby if it gives you the option to grab the email address or have people sign up for the mailing list.
Not sure either. I would assume you'd get an email address from those guys.
Yeah,
with iTunes, you definitely don't. You know
you do with Bandcamp, mm-hmm. but iTunes, Amazon, you don't.
Yeah.
And for even just to make this slightly better, just having some more images like logos and this is all text links, which, you know, that's not as very comfortable or pleasant buying experience.
This is your storefront. So there's the analogy of the nice storefront on Main Street. Like, you want your windows to be good looking and mm-hmm. and you want the store to feel welcoming.
Yeah. Album covers, the logos of the different stores you're available at would help.
Yeah.
The contact page. Having your email like that in clear text and a mail to link is a really good way to get spammed to death. Right. Having a lot of spam bots are going to pick this up. So you can either have a contact form. Having the phone number is good. Like, people sometimes, like a lot of industry people, like to call you directly. But email, I would do either through a contact form or putting your email address in an image. Mm. And then having that image on the contact page.
One other comment about that. When I see, this band has their own web. They have their own domain, inchofdark.com. But their email address is a Yahoo address. I booked a venue for 4 years, and if I see that a Yahoo address is the main booking email, I see it as less professional, whether are or not. It's just the impression I get on the industry side is, why do you have a Yahoo or a Gmail or a mm-hmm. Hotmail email for mm-hmm. your band's business?
Yeah, I agree. That's a really good comment. Do you want to move on?
Okay, so that's a very clean template that she used, and she has a good header image, so I think that works well. The menu, home bio, musicians, music. That to me is a little confusing. Like, what's musicians? I'm assuming that's the bios for her band, but that could be a little more clear. The band, or maybe bring that back in the bio.
Either as a drop down or just in the bio section. Mm.
This section here, let's talk, isn't clear to me either.
Like, what is that?
What is that? I'm gonna click. I'm curious. I'm gonna click on it. But that's okay. That's
a guest book.
That's a guest book. So that's very old school. Mm-hmm. But if people are using it, that's fine. If you notice that your guest book, the latest entry is again from a year ago, you can safely remove the guest book. Like, it was more useful before Facebook and social networking sites. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Even blogs are meant for more communication. Yeah. Like, Let's Talk to me says there's going to be a conversation, but a guest book is a one way.
Yeah, it's almost like it should open up a chat. You know?
Yeah, or a fan forum or something like that. Yeah. So,
back to the homepage. There's a music player here, and that's pretty cool. It's a site wide music player. So if I click play here, And I'll stop it. But then if I move to other sections, the music's gonna keep playing. Mm-hmm. Whereas if I only have a player in the page, but then I want to check out another section, the music's gonna stop. Mm-hmm. So site-wide music players are good for that.
I have one comment. So
yeah,
my eyes are starting to fail me. I'm 38, so I have a hard time. So I'm probably not Madison Shay's target demo, right? But to me, this font
is kind of
it's a little hard to read. Yeah, you know. So something to consider, who is your core demographic, and be sure that you're presenting something that works for them. I mean, something that we think about with the online school, you know. Our demo tends to be a little bit older too, and we're constantly looking at the font and the size and everything.
There's some good content on her homepage, but like her probably most important call to action, her mailing list, is at the very bottom.
Yeah.
She has a video, some social links, some latest news in her Twitter feed. If she moved to like a two column layout,
right,
she could put some of the like the mailing list call to action, the social links on the right hand side, and some of her latest news.
It's quite a bit of scrolling.
And there's a lot of wasted real estate
on
either side. So switching the two columns would really help visually.
You know, you scroll down, David, right here. This is a little bit confusing to me. It looks like the header, Madison has 6 songs on iTunes, check them out, and then an email address right there. I almost think that if I enter my email address, I'll get that.
It's
these two things
confusing.
Are not, they're not connected, but they're presented in a way that it looks like they should be, you know?
Yeah,
there's a lot going on with this page. It's kind of like it doesn't feel cluttered just because it's very spaced out.
Yeah.
But again, she's going to lose a lot of impact because maybe right now her, like she has great news. She won an award. So maybe that's the main piece of news right now. But that means I'm missing the fact that she has 6 songs that I could be downloading.
Right.
So I would kind of clean this up. And above the fold, focus on the main call to actions and the main news items, and that like very easily that homepage could be fixed, and be a lot more effective. It's good to have the latest tweets. That's kind of the latest news, the latest thing that are going on.
Yeah, if you're not uploading like your own latest news through your site, embedding your latest tweets, if you're active on Twitter, can be effective. But both, I think, is kind of overkill.
Yeah.
It becomes visually confusing if you have latest news scrolling on one side and your Twitter feed on one, and then you have your Facebook feed.
Ton going on there.
You know, there's just too much.
Yeah.
So that's a Flash
That's an example of using a Flash widget from Reverb Nation. You can right-click on, if you're not sure, you can always right-click on an item, and you'll see Adobe Flash Player.
And Reverb Nation does offer HTML5.
They revamped all their widgets, and they look great. They're really visually very nice, and they're HTML5. So she just would have to go back to her account and update the HTML.
So Madison can make a quick change here, no problem.
That'll take 2 minutes.
Yeah. Photo gallery. So that's good. Good professional photos. Yeah, that's nice. I mean, like, you should keep the best photos on your website. Like, don't empty the memory card of your little point and shoot on your website, but to keep like the best photos. It's also fun to have photos that your fans provided on the website. It's a nice touch. So she has a video section. It seems like she's a young singer. She doesn't have too much content, so maybe the music and video sections could be condensed into one and have more of an impact.
She's got some great photos, though. I mean, I'm really impressed with a lot of what she's got going on.
One thing I'd like to see on the videos, sorry if you stayed on that page for one second.
Is that more of a story?
Yeah, I like to see some content. Like, it's great that she embedded YouTube videos on her site, because, again, going back to what we said before, I mean, you send someone to YouTube, they're going to be watching a crazy cat video in 5 seconds.
Yeah.
So it's great that you have them. You're going to get the plays, the hits for your videos. So see, here she has some context, like some titles for the videos. Like, I love seeing a little descriptor of what you're about to see. If it's on your site, you have the ability to add a little bit of text. And so for those ones down at the bottom, she has those. It'll encourage people to click. Like, these ones don't have any context.
You're not sure what you're getting.
Give us some context. Like,
played this festival in front of 10,000 people. Here's the video.
Why did you like this performance? Was special because of this. That will make me more eager to click on it and actually check it out.
I mean, that even could help with SEO if you're tagging the festival.
Absolutely,
That as well, yeah.
Absolutely. So for a store, she uses an Audio Life. Okay, so that's a Reverb Nation. Audio Life.
Is that
it's an on-demand?
I don't think that's Flash.
That's
I think that's one of the HTML5. So that's good. I mean, that's fine. She's using that. Like, what you need to make sure with whoever your commerce provider is that it's extremely easy for your fans to buy your music or merch.
Does she have music for sale right here?
Yeah, she, well, no, not here. She, if you scroll up, she just has an iTunes logo. Yeah. So being a Banzoogle member, she could have her EP there and collect email addresses with those purchases and keeping all the money. But you can also offer, at the end of the day, some people are only going to buy music on iTunes or Amazon. They're just, so giving them the option is fine, but don't focus on that.
That's right.
Try to get those direct sales first.
You're going to get an email address and then your margin's going to be higher too.
Yeah, you know? Exactly. I mean, that email address can translate into hundreds, even thousands of dollars over the span of your career rather than 66 cents from iTunes.
That's right.
You know, it's a good business decision to try to focus on direct sales.
See, that's a good way to do a contact form. First name, last name, who are you? But then is your message about booking, questions, et cetera. That way, they're not necessarily exposed to your email. Mm-hmm. And the spam bots are not exposed to your email, but you're going to get those emails. And it looks very professional. I think it's very clean. She did put a mail to link to one of her email addresses, though. So
for her
she
fans,
could
yeah.
she could just add that, like, directly contact Madison and have that here. She could probably remove this, but yeah, that's a good contact page. Should we go to the next?
Let's go to one from Danielle, and it's daniellemusic.com.
Yeah, all right.
D-A-N-I-E-L-L-E.
One quick note while you're typing in the address bar there. For a contact page, what I also like to see is the mailing list sign up again and social links. I often will just click on a contact page to see if I want to find an artist's Twitter address or Facebook address. I'll go to their contact page, and a lot of times it's not there. You have to surf around the site or scroll down and try to find that. Contact page, I want to see email, phone number, you know, social links.
Any number of people could be going there for different reasons.
For different reasons, yeah.
People that book clubs or,
So that's a good example. I'm going to reload Danielle's website because I don't think it's Flash, probably HTML5, but having a whole website that loads, it's kind of tricky. I don't know how this website looks on a mobile device or if someone is on a slow connection. Often people are like might be in a bad 3G area and they're trying to get... So if you have something that needs to load before... completely before people can access your website, it can be tricky. So her navigation like is like a central. I'm not a fan of like weird navigation like this.
This is a lot of the homepage is where you want to make an impression on.
Yeah.
It's a great opportunity to make a first impression on people, and this is not telling me anything about the artist, what kind of music she plays.
It's not helping her SEO.
Not helping her SEO. There's no content there. There's no music. There's no sign up for email. There's no social links. It's kind of a static page.
See, what I see also is, I mean, I kind of like this little logo, the owl and the name, but this could be just in the header, you know, on a regular site, and then a kind of a more standard information-based page beneath.
You see how more, like, okay, so then when I click, it kind of opens up a window, and the menu moves down to here, which, like, to me, again, it looks flashy, it things move, and... But at the end of the day, it's not helping navigation. It's not helping your business goals. And I always say, if you're an artist, you're a singer, you're in a band, your art is your music is your art. Your website is your business. Mm-hmm. So don't try to be too artsy about your website, because your website is there for the business part of your career. Mm-hmm. So, but that said, like the. That's good. That's her bio. Again, the bio is very long. She could have like a one paragraph bio, and then have more details under it. Playlist. I would just call music. I'm assuming it's either videos or audio. Okay, so that's just a video.
Just one video. Yeah. So I was expecting to see some kind of audio player that had a song list of several songs.
Yeah, there's no list here. There's just one video.
So that could just be a videos page or a video page.
All this loading, you see the little thing that loads?
Each time this is taking time to load the content.
And all this swooshing around is, like, it looks good once, but then you want people to come back to your website.
That's right.
So don't, then it doesn't work as well. Like, I don't know what the Facebook,
clear. Like, on your photo section to have the follow me on Facebook, like, that should be somewhere else on your site. That's one of the last places I would look to find, to connect to an artist on Facebook would be a photo.
She has
session.
Some interesting pictures, so I guess that's a good thing. It gives a good idea of who the artist is.
And I like to see more of that incorporated into the actual homepage.
I
like to see the picture, a photo of the artist, because it's more personal. You get an impression of the artist. That's a really cool logo, like you said, the owl, and the typography is great, but incorporating her image and maybe making that more of a header image, I think would be much more effective.
Yeah. Having the Facebook link on the contact
that makes more
form
sense.
Makes more sense than having it in the photos, but it's even better to have it on a homepage.
It's definitely not intuitive to have the nav down below, bottom left. You know, a lot of people's eyes want to move up top and look for the nav.
Now I like big horizontal menus at the top. That's where our brain are wired. Like,
that's true.
Our brains now kind of tune out the sidebars, just because that's usually where ads live, and we're starting to tune out those ads. And this is kind of awkward. I mean, their website isn't bad. Most it's very simple. You can tell she's getting started, and there's not a lot of content. But I would use much easier, cleaner navigation. What's next?
So yeah, we can look at one, maybe two more.
This is also a Banzoogle website, I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
My first reaction is that that's clean and simple, which is good. But having red, white, and yellow fonts, just that adds a bit of clutter in terms of how the site is designed. So I would.
It's a little taxing on the eyes.
I would probably remove the yellow fonts on links, and just that would make it a bit better. That's kind of okay. There's a shot of the artist and then the logo, so having both is a good thing.
To me, visually, it seems like two separate headers almost.
Kind of
if it can be incorporated into the logo somehow, that or just having this with a photo of the artist. Somewhere on the home page.
It takes a bit of scrolling down to see any music, and actually there's no music above the fold. So I would use like we've said earlier, I would keep this. That's his phone number. So I would keep that for a contact page. I would have a quick bio. Could be just this, like Brian Cooper's a versatile musician. And then a track, especially a track that features his drumming.
A video would be great in this case.
Yeah, you're right.
Yeah.
Having upcoming performances, Facebook feed, that's okay, that's good. The store is kind of pushed down though. Does he have a menu? There's a menu item called store, so that's a good thing. Again, mailing list is kind of an afterthought, but pushed down all the way down. I would bring him back above the fold. Let's check out the other section. He has three about sections. So that's a way to do it, because obviously he's a performing artist, but he's also a lighting and sound professional. So that's a good way to kind of blend three websites into one.
Yeah, I was going to ask about that, because that's not uncommon to see folks that want a website for their music and for their creative arts. You know, you think this is a good way to do it?
It's an okay way to do it. Yeah. I think if one becomes more important than the other, you should have a website that focuses on your performing.
Mm-hmm.
Or if you're a performing artist, but you also run a studio as a standalone business, like you probably need a website for the studio,
because
you're not trying to reach the same people. You're not trying to get them to do the same thing on the website.
Right.
But if you're getting started, like a lot of especially students. When they graduate, they're kind of not exactly sure where their career is going to take them. It's a good idea to have all you can do on your website. And in this case, it depends. Like, he could possibly break it down in a different way, but it's not necessarily bad having personal information.
This disclaimer here probably isn't necessary. Just warning people that external links will open in a new window.
Yeah.
And that appears in several spots. So you're making people read the same sort of disclosure. I mean, it's kind of common practice that links will send you out. So you could probably remove that. I'd rather be reading relevant information about him than a disclaimer about links.
He has many photo galleries based on the year. So it could be a good idea to... Oh, that's strange. So that's a broken link. You should fix that link. probably works here. But one good idea would be to use this main photo gallery page. I don't know why it's not loading now. But use that main photo gallery page to have, you know, maybe his 10 best pictures. Mm. Like highlight some of the good pictures and then have the whole archive under it. If people want to browse back to pictures from 2010, for example.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and I'd like to see, even with the different about pages, I'd like to see more visuals. Yeah. So like one image from each of these, if he's going to keep this format, one image from each gallery, and then you click that to get the rest of the gallery. Text links are kind of boring. They're not, not very encouraging to navigate.
Yeah.
So in his media gallery page, he has an audio player. So that's good. That's what I said earlier, like having a whole playlist instead of just individual tracks that people need to click on. And then a bunch of videos. Like your comment earlier that there could be a descriptive for each video that could make this page much a bit
and
better.
Take that one of the best videos and put it on the homepage. I think
absolutely,
would be a great improvement.
The store, like again, the store he's sending folks to Amazon.
I think in this case
they're not his recordings. They're probably recordings that he contributed to or his friends, I guess. Yeah, I'm not sure.
It's people he's played with.
But yeah, if his goal is to send a lot of traffic to Amazon, then that's a good page.
Yeah.
If your goal is to
maybe sending traffic to his friend's site, you know.
Instead of Amazon. Yeah. Yeah.
But I'm sure this is an affiliate link.
Yeah.
So
yeah. Exactly. Yeah.
It's probably generating a little bit of income for himself.
Let's do one more really quick.
So this is a splash page. So intro pages. We're not a huge fan of intro pages. It's bad for SEO, first of all, because it's a static page. This one, basically what he's doing is sending people away to social media right away. It's hard to see where to get into his site. There's a tiny little text link, continue to his .com. If you're going to use an intro page, there are certain practical uses for them, but there needs to be a call to action. Mm-hmm. So it's, if you have a new album out,
right,
prompt people that you have your new album, click here to purchase, or
if you're doing a Kickstarter, you know, a time constrained campaign. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. But it should be temporary, a few weeks, maybe a month, and then take it down, because your fans who are coming back, it's an extra click each time to get to your website. So so this is an example of an intro page that I would recommend he remove completely, because he's basically just sending people away from his site.
Okay, so the homepage. Well, one good thing is that there's a video straight on the homepage. Big news. So that's a piece of news. I would probably replace that by a quick bio, quick pitch, and maybe bring that back a bit further down. He could use a wider template as well. That's an okay template, but there are ways to make it wider, or use a wider template, or use the custom style editor to use, because he has good image. I think like the image on his splash page fit better than this template. Then there are good call to actions during the mailing list, the fan club, social media links. The tweets aren't showing up, so I'm not sure what's going on there. Mm-hmm. Either the widget is broken or it's not configured, so I would fix that. The menus, home, about us, audio, which is kind of awkward. Is it about us, about me?
Yeah.
Is it a band or just a solo artist? Audio and video, so that's good. Photos, events, store, press, contact us. So let's go through these very quickly. It's very long.
Everything is in italics.
Yeah, that font is a little awkward.
It's bold italics, so I would unbold. It's dense. It's hard to read on the eyes. So if you take the bold off and just bold certain passages or certain lines, it'll be more effective. But to have bolded text for the entire body text is very taxing on the eyes. It's hard to read.
I'm not a fan of music that auto starts anywhere, like either on the homepage or on the music page.
Yeah.
Like people are smart. There's a big play button here, so don't make the player auto start. They might be already listening to music, and then your music just adds up to just becomes noise. They might be at work and not necessarily in the position to be hearing your hot new track.
Is this a Reverb Nation widget?
That's actually a Banzoogle widget.
It's a Banzoogle player,
a playlist player that is embedded.
And you have the ability to auto start or not auto start in Banzoogle.
Yeah, we like
you should disable on the Banzoogle side. Yeah.
In spite of our opinion, it's Kenny's website, so he can do what he wants.
Yeah. But make it really hard for them to do that.
Yeah, it's not the default option. Let's just say that.
Okay.
And then sends to SoundCloud. Okay, that's okay. Let's store. Let's look at his store. See, that's an okay store. That's a card. Very easy. Wristband. It's good to sell merch. You know, for your fans, have different options. Autograph photo, a combo. The image here is broken, so maybe he needs to fix his image or upload a different image. But yeah, overall, the store works. Upcoming events. I'm not a big fan of using the calendar format for events, just because it's like he's pretty busy, so in his case it kind of works. But usually, I prefer seeing just a list of what's coming up.
Mm-hmm.
You can see that he's a regular. Like he's got regular gigs at different venues.
Still a little tricky to
read.
Yeah,
it's very small. It's a very small font. But I would list it. I would. And have it like just use like a text feature saying like every Thursday I'm at the Sticks and Stones.
Or Big Daddy's Saloon.
Yeah. That sounds like a lot of fun.
You know, I'm being told we got to wrap it up.
We got to wrap it up.
Yeah.
Awesome.
Thank you so much for coming in here. You guys are really
great. Thanks for
having us. I really appreciate it. I learned a lot, so it was good to have you guys here.
Cheers.
Thanks for having us. Thank you.